Welcome to Chapter 6 discussion on protein. We're going to start by talking about protein structure. And to the left here, what you see is a string of amino acids. And these are just three amino acids. Amino acids are the building blocks of protein. We'll go into more detail about this, but the structure of protein is much more complex than that of carbohydrates and lipids. And here, what you can see is the blue or the turquoise represents carbon, whereas the purple represents the nitrogen and the red, the carboxyl group. What I want you to know about that is that these units here are representing an amino acid. So you can see three amino acids, and they're linked together by a very strong peptide bond. So they're very, very tightly bound. And then the nitrogen really makes this unique. If we take a closer look at the amino acids, you can see here the nitrogen that I was talking about, and then the bonds. You're not required to know the structure. This R just represents the side chain or the side unit of the amino acids, as there are 20 standard amino acids that we'll be referring to. The categories of amino acids are divided into essential, non-essential, and conditionally essential. And these are for the standard amino acids. There are actually many amino acids, but the ones that we'll be referring to. And I don't expect you to know the 20 amino acids, and you actually don't need to know which ones are essential or non-essential. But I do want you to know the definitions and what these mean. Essential is the same definition we've been talking about. This means that these amino acids, and there are 9 of them, need to be supplied by the diet. And that's because the body cannot synthesize them, cannot make these amino acids. The non-essential amino acids are the amino acids which cannot be made by the body. They can be made by the body. Sorry to confuse you. So the non-essential means that they take the essential amino acids and the body can then convert those into the non-essential amino acids when needed. It doesn't necessarily mean that some are more important to others in the body. It just means that they're important in the sense that we have to obtain those from the diet. Then there are the conditionally essential amino acids. And an example is cysteine, tyrosine. These are necessary just for infants and even more important for preterm infants. So it's only under a certain condition that they become essential. Normally the body can make them, but at times, remember the definition of essential is that the body cannot make or cannot make enough for its needs. And that's why some of the non-essential amino acids will then become conditionally essential under certain conditions. Let's take a look at this picture. And we're going to start up with this string of amino acids. So all these little balls here are representative of one amino acid. So just like we talked about, you can see the amino acid. This is just a representative of one. And when we look at this, we can see it a chain of amino acids, so they're all linked together. So this is going to create essentially a polypeptide, a chain of amino acids. This is called the primary structure. And even though it might have all the amino acids necessary, it doesn't function at all when it's just in a string or just a chain like this. Now the secondary structure, and we can see two different types of structures, is either one, this is a coil. If you can think of something coiling around, the amino acids are then bonded together in this coil, or they become sheets so that they're pleated like this. And that's the secondary structure. Now the tertiary structure is when you can take this coil or these sheets, and it then folds on itself. So if we have something that's coiled, but then that folds and then folds again, as you can see here, this is going to be our tertiary structure. At this point, the protein can become functional once it gets to this tertiary structure, but it more often functions as the quaternary structure, which is when these units here join together. And then this is generally our fully functional protein. So a key point here is that a protein shape determines its function. This right here, this primary structure, even the secondary there, this protein has all the amino acids. It's not going to function. It has to coil and then fold on itself and then generally join other units to make a functional protein. I mentioned this earlier, but I want to go back and emphasize this again. A protein's structure is much more complex than that of carbohydrates or lipids. And let's go back. Let's remember carbohydrates. And if each of these represented a carbon, you can remember this shape as being glucose, right? This is going to represent our, you know, simple carbohydrate, glucose, simple sugar. We know that lipids exist in these chains of carbon, and if they have the hydrogen fully hydrogenated, it's a saturated fat, and if we had a double bond in here, it would either be mono or polyunsaturated fat, but it's just carbon and hydrogen. Well, now we get to protein, and we have these amino acids with their side chains, they're linked together, we've got carboxyl units, and importantly, nitrogen. These are much more complex, and if we look at a bigger image, we can look at our glucose linking together to form starch, our longer chains of saturated mono, polyunsaturated fatty acids. Again, this would each be a little carbon here. But then look at protein. This is so much more complex. Think of it coiling and folding and joining. And not only because of its basic molecular structure, but also its more advanced structure, this tertiary and quaternary structure. So that's a very important part of understanding proteins. Now, we already talked about the amino acids and how they join together. They usually join here to form a very strong peptide bond. So that initial bond that they have is really strong, meaning that's harder to break apart a protein compared to, we talk about starch, how easy it is to hydrolyze or just remove those carbon fragments and utilize that for energy. This has a very strong bond, so it's much more difficult to liberate these amino acids. And what I'm showing here as far as the structure is just simply that this circle here, when we get into digestion and absorption, I'm going to be representing one amino acid just as a simple circle. And that's our end. The end of our section on the structure of protein.